Good morning. Very rarely do I need to have notes to introduce people. Eleanor Lederer is away today, and so I have the opportunity and the pleasure of introducing Dr. Bhatnagar. He did his training in India and then in Galveston, Texas, before moving here to be with us in 1998. He's been a professor of cardiovascular medicine in the Division of Cardiovascular Medicine, but he's also in the Department of Pharmacology and Toxicology and the Department of Physiology and Biophysics and the Department of Biochemistry and Molecular Biology and the School of Public Health and Informatics Sciences. He serves as the director of our Diabetes and Obesity Center. He's also director of the American Heart Association for Tobacco Regulation and Addiction, and director of his Envirome Institute. And so in 2019, he became the chief of the Division of Environmental Medicine here. He mentors 50 to 100 PhD students. He's got hundreds of publications. He has multiple book chapters and multiple R01 grants. He's on multiple review boards for the NIH. I think that's his second home. And he was awarded the Smith and Lucille Gibson Chair, as well as a Distinguished University Scholar. What I know most about Aruni is when you talk to him, he has an infectiously positive personality. He's a collaborator extraordinaire, and I don't think he sleeps. Aruni, please come on up.
Well, good morning, and thank you for that introduction. I do sleep sometimes. What I wanted to do today was actually to introduce you to a concept, and so we could look at how we understand and how we can evaluate the environment, not only in understanding of what health and disease is, but also in your profession, taking care of patients. But also, as mentioned, I was appointed as the chief of the Division of Environmental Medicine, and I wanted to sort of introduce to you some of the things that we are doing within the division and within the newly established Envirome Institute. So let's begin with this, the general concept of what human beings are. So there are two parts of the picture. The first is, of course, the human genome. We know that we are composed of genes that we have acquired over the last several million years of evolution. And that those genes that we have that we share with lots of people, but we also have a unique human genome ourselves. But that's only part of the picture, because in addition to the human genes, we also, in addition to genes, we also have our, we also have the environment. So this is part of the same puzzle that you have. Part of the what makes goes into making a human being is part of the genes as well as the environment. So although we know the human genome and we are understood, at least we have sequenced it. We might not be able to decipher all the meaning yet, but at least we know what the actual script is, the text is, and what the genome is made up of. But in contrast, we know very little about the environment, because even though we are familiar with it, we all understand what it means, we do not know what constitutes a human environment and how can we understand the environment systematically. And that's the key word. It's not just understanding all the things that are in the environment, but is there a structure to the environment, and whether that structure could be understood in order to help us better understand health and disease. So in order to understand the human environment, we have to look back into a variety of things. We know that human beings live in very complex environments, and these environments are not just a physical environment they are in, but also cultural and social environments. And we are as much as a product of our social histories and our evolutionary backgrounds and our cultural upbringing. And that has a very strong bearing on how, not only how we perceive health and health well-being, but also how we perceive disease and how we become susceptible to disease and how we would treat disease in individuals. So in order to understand sort of the human health and well-being, we need to understand human environments in all their complexity. This is critical because we know that particularly non-communicable diseases or chronic diseases originate from living in unconducive environments, living in environments that we are not in synchrony with, and because of the mismatch between our genes and our environment. And so we'll discuss that in a little bit in detail, but we grew up, or sort of say, evolved in an environment that is very different from the environment that we are now. Even two generations ago, the environment that our ancestors were in was very different from what we are now and the environment that we live in. But the environments in the past have not sort of disappeared completely, and they have imprinted a gene, so we've become what we are because as a result of our past environments. So the echoes of our past environments are embedded in our genes. And so because of our past environments may be different for different people, that we have different genetic susceptibility and different way of responding to the environment. So in order to understand the environment as a whole, we sort of develop this idea that we need to understand the different domains of the environment and what it is. So if in analogous to the genome, if we try to understand the environment as one particular entity, then we can think of it as a complete set of environmental conditions. There is a definition of the environment from Einstein who says environment is something that's not me. So anything that's not me is the environment. But given that, we still need to understand this set of conditions that affect our fitness and our health and how that affects a specific individual. And again, this is an important point that I want to stress, that we have had a lot of talk about the environment. We talk about social determinants of disease. We talk about environmental influences and exposure. But there's also individual personal environments. So like in analogy with genes, although we share genes with people around us and most commonly with people who are closest to us, but each one of us has a unique genome. So in the same sense, each individual has a unique environment. And so that's where the problem becomes very difficult in the sense in trying to understand not only a shared social environment, but environment of an individual. So in our research, mostly in the last 10, 15 years, we've been studying heart disease. And there are a lot of members of our faculty within the new division who have been involved in looking at cardiovascular disease, and that's been a major focus. So the idea was that if you're going to understand the environment, maybe cardiovascular disease would be an important non-communicable paradigm to begin to unravel the environment and its influences. We also have a diabetes and obesity center that's now run by Dr. Steve Jones. And in this center, we've been studying how diabetes and obesity affect the risk of cardiovascular disease. And the reason for the interest in the disease is that most of these diseases, both heart disease and diabetes, is about 60 to 80% preventable, and therefore to be thought of as an environmental disease, in the sense that it is made up of modifiable factors that are altered because of environmental conditions. And this is not just true for heart disease and diabetes, it's also true for cancer. About 97% of cancers are environmental. So if most of the disease is derived from the environment, we should then be able to at least devote most of our attention to environmental exposures and environmental characteristics as much as we have devoted our attention and resources to understanding the genome. So how do we understand the environment? Is there a way of approaching this problem systematically so that we can at least have a conceptual model with which to begin to sort of go and look at it and begin a scientific investigation and then be able to then translate that into clinical practice? And so if you can think of the environment, we could conceive of it in three different domains. So the first domain, which is the most primordial domain, is the natural environment. And the natural environment is the nature around us, the ecology and the geology that we're in. But embedded in that is our social environment. And the social environments are environments that we create by interacting with each other and interacting with nature. But like I mentioned, and within the social environment, there is also a personal environment. And this personal environment is populated by individual choices, by our circumstance, and by chance that we have accrued within our little microenvironments, characteristics and features and things that, of course, have a very important bearing on health and well-being. And so I would go through each of these domains to sort of make the case that all of them have important implications in determining our health. So let's begin with the natural environment. Of course, the natural environment is a set of environmental conditions that are defined by both components of the geosphere and the biosphere. So in the geosphere, you would have things like geography of a place that you're in, the features of the land that you live in, and then there is the biosphere, which contains of all the microorganisms, plants, and animals. So at least for the biosphere, I don't need to emphasize the point that they are very important to our health and well-being. We are surrounded with microbes all the time. We have gut microbiome, which consists of more bacteria than number of cells than we have in our body. We carry around our cells in our skin and our hair and our nails a very large number of different microorganisms. And so we are actually a system of different living species living together in a one particular individual. So, and we well know well that there are infectious diseases that make us susceptible, and for the most part in human history, these infectious diseases have been the major causes of morbidity and mortality, and so they have been much, much more important. But in the last 50 years, the non-communicable diseases have arisen, and so now that needs sort of prompts us to look at something different, and though at first glance it may appear odd that we can talk about geography and meteorology in terms of health, but as I would argue that this is really critical to our health. So the first and the most primordial aspects of the natural environment are the cycles of night and day. And all life on this planet, at least, is entrained to this life cycle. We have a superchiasmic nuclei in our brain, which has an intrinsic clock of 23 hours and 43 minutes. And we are all entrained into this with repeated doses of sunlight and food and activity. And any deviation from that has important consequences on health. So if you change rhythms, for example, in circadian rhythms in individuals, you enhance the risk of diabetes and obesity, as well as heart disease. There are several studies showing that there is susceptibility to cardiovascular events. For example, most MIs happen between 3 to 6 a.m., and that even if people are moved to a different place, for example, there's a study showing that people living in Japan, when they move, they come to Hawaii for vacation, then they have their heart attacks at Japan time, at least for the first through a couple of days. And when they acclimatize themselves to living in Hawaii, then they have their heart attacks in Hawaiian time in early in the morning. So this sort of circadian pattern dominates. About 16 to 20% of our genes oscillate on a base of 24 hours. And we have been studying that in our group. Petra Haberzittel has been studying how the circadian rhythms affect our susceptibility to environmental exposures. But in addition to that, we also have the rhythms of seasons. So seasons change, and with that, our physiology changes as well. And it's very sort of poorly understood how these seasons have an effect on health and cardiovascular effects. So one of the things is there are more cardiovascular deaths in winter than in summer, almost twice as much. And in the eastern United States, we thought this is because people are living indoors and they have, influenza, and then they fall sick. But this data is from from Los Angeles, and I don't know if you've been there, but there is no winter to speak of. And so even in Los Angeles, you can see that the number of cardiovascular events much higher in, say, December than in June and July. And so what could be the reason for that? There's some sort of rhythmicity in our susceptibility to these events, but not necessarily relate to temperature, but may relate to sunlight. And we know that sunlight is a very critical determinant of our health. We forget that we are like plants. We undertake photosynthesis to synthesize important molecules, particularly vitamin D. And without vitamin D, that we would have a number of different physiological functions are compromised. And the effects of vitamin D vary with skin color. So the darker the skin, the less absorbance of the UV light. And then it also varies with the latitude, where you are in relationship to the latitudes and the seasons, of course. So there is this sort of increasing understanding of the role of vitamin D. We know that in the United States, at least 70% of the people are are deficient in vitamin D. We know a very large number of children are much more deficient in vitamin D, and that this deficiency is very strongly associated with the risk of cardiovascular disease, with diabetes and obesity, with increased susceptibility to cancer, changes in bone formation, immune function. So it is important for us that we pay attention to the level, not only to the levels of vitamin D, but also to sunlight exposure. Because in addition to just sort of synthesizing vitamin D, sunlight has a variety of different effects. For instance, sunlight can regulate your circadian rhythms, and a certain amount of sunlight exposure is very critical and important for proper synchronization of metabolic processes as well as disease susceptibility. We know, of course, that vitamin D can actually synthesize, sunlight is essential for synthesis of vitamin D, but we also know there are other than non-vitamin D effects of sunlight, particularly in regulation of blood pressure. And there are some recent work showing that there are nitrosothiols under the skin, and they get photolyzed in order to generate nitric oxide to reduce blood pressure. All of this sort of our relationship to the natural environment is critical. And I think as physicians and as people trying to understand cardiovascular disease or any other disease for that matter, we have to be very careful or very sort of cognizant of this relationship between ourselves and the world around us, which is the most primordial feature. So another primordial feature of our environment is green spaces. And we know that people who live close to green spaces are healthier and have a lower risk of cardiovascular disease. And this is some work that's recently been talked about in the literature. We do not know the link yet, but there is a strong association with living around green environments. We know that we are exposed to green environments in a variety of different scenarios, both in a natural environment, a social, as well as a personal environments, and that this relationship with greenery may be important, and we do not understand what the nature of this link is. But if you look at large population, and this data is from England, that you could see that people who live in more green spaces are almost twice as resilient to cardiovascular disease as people who live in less green spaces. We also know that there is a relationship with cardiovascular mortality with changes in greenness. And this is data from the United States showing that loss of ash trees, which was infected by the Chinese borer beetle, was associated progressively in time with increased cardiovascular mortality. So in communities where trees are dying progressively, people are dying as well. So this is, if this link is true, this is some important sort of relationship that we need to pay attention to. There are studies showing that people who live in green spaces have lower mortality. This is data from the Nurses' Health Study of about a very large number of participants over several years, women who live in more green spaces have much lower mortality. And some people attribute this to socioeconomic status, that people who live in green spaces are richer or they maybe have a much better risk profile. But even if you adjust for these factors, that there is this persistence link between exposure to green spaces. We also know that it has a great value in recovery. And this is data that was published a few years ago showing that after surgery, if you put patients in a room facing a brick wall or a window outside looking at a garden, that you have the time to recovery was shortened by almost a day, and that patients looking out in the window of the green garden were actually required less pain medication than those looking out at a brick wall. So if you can promote recovery by enriching environment around people, that makes a difference, and it's a measurable difference, and it's not a trivial difference. So what could be the reasons for this? There is some work showing that maybe being around green spaces increases your cognition and attention, and that when you are around people or things, you have a very directed focus attention, and that when you are around nature, it is an unconstrained attention. It's attention that doesn't stress you, doesn't draw energy from you. So there is a relaxing effect of greenness and green spaces so that it restores your attention. Being shown to be particularly good with children who have attention deficit disorders, it relieves stress, and some people have sort of swear by this sort of activity or this effect of green spaces. But there's this new idea that maybe there is an effect on our immunity. So the idea is that we evolved as a species in an environment that we around all these different microbes which are maintained around us, this biodiversity that's around us. And these microbes actually educate our immune system as we age. And this education of the immune system is called, it's called the old friends hypothesis. So these microbes have been our old friends. And now that we live in this green sort of antiseptic environments, that we miss our old friends. And this, so our hypervigilant immune system has little choice but to turn inward, and that increases the risk of autoimmune diseases. So we know that children who actually live in areas which are not as clean, so they're living in farms, they're out with the pigs, they're playing in the dirt, that they have much lower cases of asthma than children who grew up in a very, very clean environment. So a certain amount of interaction with nature and with components of nature are critical in our proper development of health and well-being. We know lately from the studies that that children who stay indoors and who are reading or looking at video games have two, three times the higher risk of myopia, because there isn't enough sunlight for them, for the sunlight to educate their educate the eyeballs to form correctly. And so this interaction with the natural component of the environment is critical. There is also some sort of evidence suggests that being in a green environment enhances social cohesion. You're more outside, your neighborhood is more pleasant, and that makes a difference. So that means that having a greener environment can create interactions. And as I was pointed out later as well, that we are not really individuals, but part of these social nodes. And again, those nodes are very critical for our health and for our well-being. But we also know that plants and vegetation can remove pollutants from the air. And so that's one of the so the ideas that we thought could be worth testing is whether or not plants can remove air pollution, and that may be one of the reasons that these plants may be, or vegetation may be conducive to health. So one of the studies that we did, and this is around Louisville, we recruited about, I think about 700 individuals from around downtown and neighboring areas. And we looked at their levels of the catecholamines in the urine. And what we found, that people who live in a more green environment have a much lower levels of epinephrine. And that would mean that they're less stressed. And maybe part of the sort of protective profile of green environments may have to do with reduced levels of sort of catecholamine excretion and adrenergic stimulation. We also, on basis of this, would say that there are many, many different mediators. We do not know which one of these is important, but there are a variety of different ideas suggesting how exposure to green spaces could affect at least the risk of cardiovascular disease. So in order to sort of test this rigorously, because most of the work that has been presented or that's been done so far was kind of a sort of a cross-sectional study. So we thought, let's look at what happens if you do a longitudinal study. And so if we wanted to do something like a clinical trial, instead of giving people pills testing a device or a medication, that if we go to a community and put trees and see what will happen there. So that's a Green Heart project. It's a sort of a partnership with a variety of different partners, particularly from the National Institutes of Health, that's funding the clinical aspects of the study, and the Nature Conservancy. They are sort of funding the planting of trees into specific neighborhoods. So what we're trying to test is whether, if you expose people to more greenness, would that decrease the risk of heart disease, and that this may be associated with decreasing the levels of air pollution around a particular area. So what can we do with this trial? We have selected a neighborhood within Louisville, and this is between Churchill Downs and the airport. And this is a neighborhood of about 23,000 people with sort of low to middle income group. And that we did a survey of every single tree in the area. We know where the air pollution are. We did the monitoring, and you can see the areas where with red is where there's high levels of air pollution. And so the idea is that we can put trees strategically in the places where there is high levels of air pollution and see what that will do to the cardiovascular health of people in the neighborhood. And then so we can have to monitor all the levels of pollutants within this neighborhood, and then we can plant trees. Maybe they're not just large trees, but very large trees, about 30 to 40 foot trees, and then we put 10,000 trees into this neighborhood. And then sort of cover up the rest of the area with some shrubs and see if we suddenly increase greenness within a year, what will happen to the health of the people there. In order to evaluate cardiovascular health, we're going to look at, of course, basic cardinal risk factors for heart disease, but also look at things like arterial stiffness, which is an indication of biological aging, And then we look at flow-mediated dilation, which is a measure of the vascular function. So what we want to see is this progression of arterial stiffness that happens with age, the change in that would be attenuated if there was a certain increase in greenness in a neighborhood. And so that will sort of test the idea that maybe greenness is associated with better health and well-being. So after 4 years, we have started this about a few years ago, 2 years ago, and we have, thanks to Rachel Keith, who's one of the members of our new division, we have actually recruited about more than 700 people for the study, and that we have all collected all the baseline data. We completed almost all the baseline data on this fall, and then we started planting trees. In fact, this weekend we're starting to start with a tree planting project. It'll take us about a year and a half to plant trees, and then we'll go back again to look at what happens to the risk, cardiovascular risk of people in the community. But trees are one thing, and we are testing that. But as I was saying, that there are other aspects of the natural environment that have an important bearing on the risk of cardiovascular disease. And these are data from both the north and the south of equator. So if you go up north or you go up and down south, you can see a gradient of blood pressure and the prevalence and the incidence of hypertension. And again, that may have to do with light, but may have to do with other features. But it's only one part of the geography. The other part of the geography is the altitude. We know that people who live on higher altitudes are healthier. We also know that children who are born on high altitude, even if they go down or come down to sea level, maintain this advantage, and that there are certain populations of people, particularly like Tibetans or Andean Indians, who are adapted to living in high altitude with a variety of changes in the physiology, mutations of hemoglobin, change in the coronary tree, and so on. So we also know that people who are moving from higher altitudes to lower altitudes preserve this health. And so this is data from Switzerland showing that for every 100 meter increase in the height, there is a 12% decrease in cardiovascular disease risk. And so there is sort of this old idea in medicine that people, I think this is the 19th century, when they were sick would go and recoup in the mountains. And so there was some sort of reason for doing that. And I think we've forgotten all those ideas, and we all think that that's, we can treat things with drugs and so on, and we never take into account the natural environment. But I think that there is evidence suggesting that there may be some benefit of living in high altitudes. We also have to be careful about how we respond to different medications, and maybe there are certain areas in which some medications do better than areas that medications don't do so well, and this mismatch of the environment that we face may have an important bearing on how we respond to different drugs. Certainly, we know that populations of humans migrating from, say, Africa to Europe have a gradient of, say, the angiotensin gene. And so how you regulate blood pressure may depend upon the evolutionary history of an individual or where they derive from and what type of responses their renin-angiotensin system has compared to those who have a different ancestry. So there is this sort of idea that we need to pay attention not only to the current geographic state, but also to the evolutionary history of an individual. But within this, all this natural environment is our social environment, and the social environment is something that we create for ourselves, and it is a very complex set of conditions, and it is mostly characterized by where we are in the social order. And this is very critical because there have been studies, two very large studies, one from Bell Labs over 35 years, showing that the more education you have, the more money you make, the healthier you are. But that's not the whole story. The study from what is called a British civil service study, and the civil servant study showed that where you are in the pecking order makes a huge difference. So if you are in a position of power and that you could, you know, boss over a few people, you're healthier than if you're lower in the pecking order, right? So people who are making the same amount of money but had a higher socioeconomic prestige in the sense they had more power over other people, that they were healthier than people who were listening to commands and were lower in the pecking order. Incidentally, that only works for men. It doesn't work for women. So women are not that sort of sensitive to power structures as men are. But regardless, there are a variety of reasons why wealth is important, and it's been shown in studies after studies that as education levels increase, as wealth increases, the risk of chronic disease goes down. We also have to pay attention to social networks. And these social networks are critical because, as I mentioned, we are all little nodes in these networks and not sort of divorced individual entities. And there was a very interesting study came out of Boston last year showing that you could, if you look at the Twitter feed of an area and you look at all the words that are negative and positive, the amount of negative words could predict the cardiovascular disease risk much better than if you measured cholesterol of everybody in that area. So how we perceive the world around us has an important bearing on our disease risk. People who have a strong, what they call life purpose, actually live better or live longer because they adhere to the medication, they are more sensitive to the risk factors, and they are have a healthier risk profile. So we have to incorporate these social structures within our understanding of human disease. We also know that we live in an environment that is very important determinant of our health. For example, the built environment. If you live in houses like this with no greenness around, nowhere to move, that there is obviously going to be a great sort of risk to your health. So particularly, you know, as physicians, I'm sure you see people and say, oh, you know, you need to exercise and you need to have a better diet. But if you just go and tell people you need to exercise and then you have them live in cities where it's impossible to walk, it's an impossible demand. So it is not that an individual choice has been taken away from people by creating environments that have constrained the way they can live their lives. And then we say, you need to have a lifestyle change, right? So that lifestyle change is not going to occur because there really is not much of a choice of changing a life if you're living in a certain set of built environment. Part of the problem of the built environment is also air pollution. I'm sure you've heard a lot about this. 7 million premature deaths worldwide could be attributed to air pollution, about 150,000 in the United States. And we have a very active program studying the effects of air pollution. Dr. Conklin is working on air pollution. We have an inhalation lab. Dr. O'Toole is doing a clinical trial trying to look if there are dietary supplements that could attenuate the effects of air pollution. So this is an important consideration. But the important thing that the reason we are interested in air pollution, because 80% of the premature deaths from air pollution are due to heart disease. And we seldom pay much attention to this. We know that people who live in areas of high pollution, for example, next to major roadways, have much more difficult time in recovering from an event like a stroke or an MI than people who live in more clean spaces. We never take that into consideration, that the environment that people live and the things that they're exposed to could be an important sort of factor in regulating their responses to medication as well as their recovery from events. If you look at all the different types of environmental exposures and look at the outcomes, you think the cardiovascular disease is the major outcome of all environmental exposures. So we think that when you're exposed to chemicals, adverse conditions, the most effect is going to be on your cardiovascular health. And this is very strange because for many, many years, we thought of all these environmental exposures and chemicals as causing cancer. You know, if you say something like cancer-causing chemicals as a household word, nobody says heart disease-causing chemicals, right? It doesn't sort of roll off the tongue. It's not a part of our normal dialogue. But the fact is that cardiovascular people exposed to adverse conditions are almost twice, if not more, likely to die from heart disease than from all the other types of diseases combined. So we need to then understand what the nature of heart disease is and whether most of it is derived from these adverse environments and living in dissynchrony with nature. So in order to understand how heart disease could relate to exposures, we established a few years ago the Superfund Center at the University of Louisville. And part of the charge of the center is to understand how exposure to these volatile gases could affect the risk of cardiovascular disease in our community. We know that in Louisville, up next to the river and around the area, we have a Superfund site. We have three Superfund sites within 50 miles of where we are sitting. And these Superfund sites contain a place where we have dumped chemicals for decades. And now these chemicals are causing problems. We cannot clean them up, and so we don't know what to do. So the least we could do is to study what influence that those chemicals might have on our health. And so we started this center 2 years ago. We are part of a network of 23 different centers and trying to understand what are the consequences of these exposures maybe to our cardiovascular health. But finally, within the larger domain of the natural and social environment, as I mentioned, we have a personal environment. And this personal environment is created both by our choices and circumstance. So there is a famous saying, you know, that heaven is a marriage between circumstance and disposition. So if your disposition matches your circumstance, you're in a very perfect situation. But obviously that's not usually the case, and even though we try to create healthy personal environments, we usually fail to do so. But these environments are characterized by how much money we make, how much education we have, how much physical activity we undertake, and so on. And that also depends upon the people around us, our family. There was a study showing that the single most important determinant of a person's health is his or her mother's last degree, education degree. So the education of a family or a group of people continues socially to an individual environment and affects how that person will grow up and how healthy that person is going to be. But there are important characteristics. As I mentioned, sleep is important because we need to get coordinate with ourselves with a circadian rhythm, physical activity, the type of houses we live in, type of friends around us. For example, we know that obesity is a rampant problem in us in our culture. We have spent 50 years trying to look at a gene for obesity, and the gene for obesity has been called the fat gene, obviously, but it's fatty acid transporter gene, and if you have a variant of that gene, which is out of several GWAS studies, you have a 0.5 to 1% higher risk of being obese. But if you have an obese friend, you have a 50% chance of being obese. So that tells you somewhat of a scale of how much genetic factors influence these chronic diseases, how much environmental factors influence these chronic diseases. So in our personal environments, we see the important thing is housing, how where we live, what type of exposures we have in-house. There are a lot of sources of pollution in houses that most people have. We have our houses that are built that have a lot of exposure to things outside. We create more pollutants by cooking, by lighting incense, by using air fresheners. Even our children, we take these garments, they're called wrinkle-free shirts or sleeping clothes. They are wrinkle-free because they've been soaked in formaldehyde. And that's why they're wrinkle-free. And then we put them on our children, and we think that, you know, we are trying to bring them up and healthy, and unaware that there are these written sources of exposure within our personal environment that we need to pay attention to, and that if we alter even a little bit would make the biggest difference, because the personal environments are most proximal to us than our social or natural environments. Of course, the biggest thing is nutrition. We do not know that what is a really a healthy food, but we do know that healthy eating sensibly could be an important determinant. I don't know if you saw this story just this week. There was a whole new meta-analysis suggesting that red meat is not bad for you. And then there is a whole group of people who have been saying for years that red meat was really bad and it enhances the risk of disease. So the problem, again, is I think fundamentally the problem of how we gather scientific evidence. And the problem there is that since we cannot do randomized controlled trials, since we only can look at data from observational studies, that we are always going to be short of actually making some sensible conclusions. But the only sort of the advice that have sort of makes sense for now, given our evolutionary history, is that human diet should be varied. That it is perhaps a wrong way of looking at diet by thinking about that you should eat this or that, or this is bad and that is good. There is, since we have adapted or evolved to eat both meats and plants and vegetables and a whole range of anything that's edible, so there is the advantage to being this omnivorous evolutionary past, which means that variety could be one thing that we could pay attention to. But then in addition to nutrition, there's of course physical activity. And we have a large group of investigators doing research on how physical activity affects health and well-being. We know that you can add about 2 to 3 years of a person's life by increased physical activity. But that is only part of the story. There you can have, you can see work that's been shown, that has shown that if you have, if you're regularly active, that you could have at least 15 years of sort of disease-free life, at least in the end of life. So that's really critical and important. But again, the interesting thing is we do not know how physical activity exerts its benefits. We know that physical activity can decrease blood pressure, can improve your lipid profile, but that only explains about 50% of the benefits of physical activity. In our group, Jason Hellman is doing work showing that physical activity improves immunity, and that regular physical activity can enhance your resilience to infection, but more importantly, that it can resolve the inflammation once that inflammation develops. And that's very critical because a lot of different diseases are related to this chronic inflammation. And so if you can improve your ability to resolve inflammation, that could be one of the benefits of physical activity. But then in the personal choices, we cannot sort of omit smoking. It remains the leading cause of mortality. And we have established within our group a tobacco center looking at the different effects of smoking. And this is a very large center with 12 different institutions around the country. We have several investigators here, Dr. D. Philippes, Dr. Walker, Dan Conklin, Dr. Srivastava, Rachel. All of these people are part of the tobacco center. And I think the part of the center is to be able to understand how we are going to deal with tobacco products. And this has really become very critical and topical. I don't know if you followed the stories lately of all these vaping-related illnesses that we have been, our center has been saying for years that we have to be cautious about e-cigarettes, that their effects of these devices are not known, and that we cannot predict what the outcome could be. Despite all these warnings, we have had these unregulated merchandising of e-cigarettes. They've addicted a whole new generation of youth. There are 18-year-olds who are addicted to vaping, and then we're seeing this large spate of illnesses around the country, including several deaths. So which brings to the point that we have been studying tobacco and smoking for a long time, but we still do not know the fundamentals, and that if we change anything about tobacco exposure or tobacco delivery devices, that we have to go back to the drawing board again, reevaluate them, and as a society, we cannot tolerate this sort of unregulated sort of access to a variety of different products which have no proven efficacy and no proven safety. So that's, I think, a very important work that I think we are currently embarking on. So, but finally, I would say that if we are going to evaluate someone and try to assess their health, then we need to, in addition to their biology, pay attention to the environment. If diseases like heart disease and diabetes and obesity and even cancer originate from the environment, we cannot just be treating the effects of that because we are only playing with the causes. We can put stents, we can give statins, but we are not getting to the root of the problem, which is derived from the environmental origins. So in addition to taking somebody's medical history and physical history, it may be important to also pay attention, even in a small measure, to the environmental history, because I think that would be very gainful in understanding who that individual is and how that individual could be most appropriately treated. In some cases, maybe there is not a pharmacological treatment. There may be certain changes in lifestyle, certain changes in the environment that may be much more beneficial than actual drug treatment or procedures. But we have to figure this out early, because all the choices that we make keep accruing on a system and leave scars that one day erupt to adverse consequences. And so we need to understand what are these sort of subclinical events that happen and how early interventions can make a huge difference. We know that in order to understand sort of personalized medicine now, that we have to do life histories, and the type of trauma and the type of adverse conditions that people face in early childhood leave a mark. There's a lot of studies showing that there are epigenetic modifications by childhood adversity that actually manifest later in life and then cause all these diseases and maybe even greater susceptibility to disease. And so that's what we're trying to sort of understand and explore the idea that can we gainfully understand the environment and use it to the sense that we can then be able to make add a new chapter of what medicine is, rather so that we can go not just from the sort of art of medicine, but to the science of healing, that we can understand disease in its very origin and not just be stuck with trying to treat all its symptoms. And so we've created with this idea the Envirome Institute. The Envirome Institute is sort of an administrative structure. It has sort of works with a variety of different centers, and it looks at medicine not just as something of treatment of working with disease, but in trying to see how we can promote health and well-being, so that we can go from even in prevention, just go from sort of passively trying to prevent disease to actively trying to promote health. And once we get into this active, proactive mode of promoting health, then I think we can make a bigger difference than just trying to ease symptoms and to offer palliative care. So I'm going to stop now and see if you have any questions for me. Yes, sir. Thank you. Yes, sir. Right. So we have, first of all, we wanted to conduct the study as a clinical trial. It's registered as in nihclinicaltrials.gov as a clinical trial. We have selected a group of neighborhoods, which we call the target clusters. We have 8 of these clusters, and then these are the clusters where we're going to put trees. Surrounding them is another set of 8 clusters, and those are control clusters where we're not going to plant trees. When we acquired data from our participants, which are called in-person exam, was from the control clusters as well as from the target clusters. And then once we put the trees in the target clusters, we can longitudinally follow the changes in cardiovascular disease risk in the community by reevaluating the individual level data from these individual participants. In addition, because there are 23,000 people in the neighborhood, we'll follow all the hospital admissions and mortalities so that we could look at what's happening to the health of these 23,000 people as a whole, and then try to see whether there is different outcomes in the clusters which have been greened versus clusters that have not been greened. So it's not a completely randomized control trial, but it's a control trial and with a sort of a target group with a treatment group and a placebo group. It will take us about sort of 4 years to do the first exam, but if we get sort of funded and evaluated, we can continue this for the next 10, 15 years. Because the trees, once you put them, they will keep growing anyway. No. So because the clusters have to be contiguous, because when we plant trees, there's going to be a little bit of buffer effect and whatever, aura effect. So they have to be geographically contiguous, so we couldn't randomize them. So it's not completely randomized. Yes, sir. Yes. Well, I'm glad you brought that up. It's a very interesting story. So the risk of Alzheimer's is determined by an ApoE variant. The 4 variants, epsilon 1, 2, 3, 4. So we have what we call the ancestral allele, and the ancestral allele is the ones that we share with chimps and with bonobos and apes. Then what happened, because humans were living in very close proximity to animals, and when you live in close proximity to animals, what do you have? You have lots of endotoxemia, so endotoxin in the air. And so we're constantly exposed to endotoxins. So then there was a variant, particularly in the Indo-European population, it's called epsilon 4, which is a variant on the ancestral allele. And this allele, it prevents the effects of endotoxin by soaking up the endotoxin. So it's preventive. Then, because ApoE delivers cholesterol to the brain and helps repair brain damage, it was very important in human survival, at least in early humans, because they were very susceptible to traumatic head injuries because they were banging their heads or whatever, or fighting. So the APOE4 gene enhanced the fecundity of the human populations and was selected. So now we have a group of population with the epsilon-4 variant and epsilon-1-2-3 variants. The epsilon-4 variant is protective against Alzheimer's. So this is a great example how evolutionary history tied in with cultural and social history determines the risk of an individual now at this particular time in our history. Yeah, E3, epsilon 3. Well, so the first thing, I think it's wrong at many levels. So for no gene can exist or exert its influence and develop and determine a phenotype without an environment, right? So it is always in the equation. Now, if you have monogenic diseases, like, for example, you know, PKU or something, now, if it's a semantic problem. So if you say PKU is a genetic disease, right? But it only occurs when you are eating tryptophan. So you can say PKU is 100% genetic disease, but you can say PKU is 100% environmental disease, right? If there is no tryptophan in your diet, there is no disease, right? So because we take the environment for granted as the background, that we only see variants with the genes, we don't see that they are interacting with the environment. So I think the thing to do is simply to keep restating the case that we have to pay attention to variable environments. When we are comparing people in similar environments, the effects of the environment seems to cancel out, at least in our mental calculations. But in different environments, the effects could be different. And certainly for neurocognitive sort of recovery and disease susceptibility, the environment plays a very good role, a very important role. Particularly diet plays an important role. It's what you think of environment is. So diet plays an important role. Excess physical activity plays an important role, and all of these need to be considered, not only try to understand what the cause of the disease are, but how to treat them. All right, if no more questions, thank you very much for your attention and for being here.